Penguin Random House Audio presents Outdoor Kids in an Inside World, getting your family out of the house and radically engaged with nature. This is the author, Stephen Rinella. For Katie, without you, there'd be nothing. We all have this feeling, I came into the world. Well, that isn't true. You came out of this world like a leaf comes out of a tree. Alan Watts. Author's note. This book is for anyone who feels responsible for the well-being of a child. Not only parents, but also grandparents, aunts, uncles, mentors, friends, and babysitters. Caregivers of every stripe. Indeed, raising outdoor kids may well be impossible if attempted by parents alone. Introduction. The Fish Shack. I found the answer I was seeking under a rock. The question had been burning in my mind since 2010 when my oldest son James was just a few months old. Brand new enough to seem terrifyingly fragile, but old enough to have exhausted my and my wife's appetite for sitting on the sofa and staring at him. How the hell are we ever going to get everyone out of the house? For parents, it's a question that never dies. It doesn't matter which town or city you live in. It doesn't matter if you've got four kids or one. It doesn't matter how old they are. If you're a parent or caregiver who's drawn to the title of this book, you most likely live with the knowledge that nature is important to kids. Just as likely, you feel strained and anxious about how to create impactful experiences for them in the outdoors. Every day, it seems, there's some new obstacle. At first, it's the annoyance of changing diapers and feeding a baby while away from the helpful tools of home. Then it's working around nap times and coordinating the needs of children of different ages. The 5-year-old is raring to go, but if her baby brother misses another nap, he's going to be a nightmare for the rest of the day. The complications evolve over time until you eventually land where my wife Katie and I find ourselves today as we raise 3 kids between the ages of 7 and 11, locked in a series of clashes with the kids over our insistence that outdoor time is more important than screen time. No matter what phase we're in or how temporarily frustrated I get, I always return to that rock and the lessons it offered. The possibilities it revealed are always nearby, no matter where I am. But that first discovery took place on the coast of a remote island in southeast Alaska. Years ago, I pitched in with my brothers Matt and Danny for a rundown cabin we chanced into on a piece of land a 20-minute float plane ride from the town of Ketchikan. We bought it sight unseen, each of us paying about what you'd pay for a decent used car. At the time, the 3 of us were unmarried. I had no immediate plans to have children, and certainly no long-term strategy about how I'd raise them if I did. All I wanted was a good place for fishing with my brothers that was out in the middle of nowhere, and my brothers felt the same way. We wanted a place that we could call our own, where we could trade our time in exchange for knowledge of the natural world. My life had always been based on the value of that transaction. Ever since I was a kid growing up in rural Michigan, I had taken strength and inspiration from my interactions with nature. The lessons I learned there had guided me toward success as a family member, a student, and a professional. I knew that going deeper toward nature would only bring more rewards. The fact that the cabin was home to a population of mice and a lone female mink only made it more appealing. At least these animals weren't coated in either mold or rust, which is more than you could say for any man-made objects inside the cabin. My wife, Katie, would later observe that it wasn't really fair to describe the structure as a cabin at all. That was overselling it, she said. Gradually, it became known as the Fish Shack. The main question we get from friends who visit the Fish Shack is, how did you guys find out about this place? My brother Danny has been a professional ecologist in Alaska for about 20 years. He's based out of Anchorage. In a broad sense, as an ecologist, He studies the relationship of organisms to one another and to their physical surroundings. In particular, he focuses on salmon. Salmon are an anadromous fish, meaning that they live in the sea but migrate into rivers to spawn. While many people might regard salmon as a saltwater species, because that's where they spend the bulk of their lives, Danny argues that it's better to think of them as a freshwater fish. Their lives begin in freshwater, and since they die after spawning, their lives end in freshwater. Danny's work with salmon is focused on their freshwater habitats. He studies the gravelly stream bottoms where they lay their eggs. He studies the little streamside brush piles and overhanging vegetation where the juvenile salmon go to find food and avoid predation as they migrate toward the sea. And he studies what happens when all those dead salmon carcasses rot away on the banks of the rivers or in the bellies of bears and eagles and enrich the surrounding environments with the ocean-based nutrients that were transported inland inside of their bodies as fat, bone, muscle, and gut. It was this type of research that led Danny to the general location of the fish shack. He was working on a project gathering baseline biodiversity data about populations of freshwater aquatic invertebrates, insects, mollusks, crustaceans, along randomly selected salmon stream segments in southeast Alaska. In ecology, gathering baseline data is an operational term for taking measurements in an environment at a fixed moment. You're asking, what lives here right now at this moment in time? You do this without making assumptions about how things used to look or what they're supposed to look like now. In doing that work, Danny became friends with a local man who's a member of the Tsimshian tribe. One day, a couple of years later, that friend called to let him know about an old shack that was up for sale nearby. We bought the place, then chartered a float plane so that we could fly out and have a look at what we now owned. At first, we discovered that we now owned a lot of garbage. Of the 2-acre parcel, about half was covered in decades worth of refuse. Rusted out oil drums, rotted lumber, head-high piles of wet fiberglass insulation, jumbles of twisted logging cable, junked out outboard engines, paint and tar cans, irreparable boats, hundreds of yards of kinked polyethylene pipe, and all manner of other junk. The refuse was so overwhelming that you almost didn't notice the astounding specimens of old-growth hemlock and cedar that towered over the land and shack. The building itself was set on pilings, with half of the shack jutting out to the tide line. The structure was maybe 40 feet long and 12 feet deep. Not a straight line or right angle could be found on the place. It looked as wavy as the surrounding ocean. There was no electricity. Water was drawn from the creek and run through PVC pipes that were fastened to the inside walls with brackets and rusty screws. Heat came from a smoky stove powered by a drip line of fuel oil. In short, it was perfect. I'm talking about love at first sight. Unbeknownst to me at the time, the fish shack wasn't just the best purchasing decision I had ever made. It was the best parenting decision I would ever make. Like many parents, Katie and I have had to move our kids all around the country as we've pursued various work opportunities. At this point, our 11-year-old, James, has lived in 5 different homes across 3 different states. It might sound strange, but that little shack stands in his mind as a point of security. He first visited the shack when he was 5 months old, and it remains the one physical location that he's known for his entire life. Same for his 9-year-old sister, Rosemary, and his 7-year-old brother, Matthew. Collectively, they've shed a considerable amount of blood on the barnacle-covered rocks that are guaranteed to shred a kid's hands and knees whenever they fall along the beach. In turn, the blood of that place runs through their veins. The second time we brought James there, he found them, the treasure trove of rocks along the water's edge. He waddled right over to one and flipped it over, and out crawled 2 crabs. He went wild with glee. Then he started flipping over more rocks in search of more secrets. And that was it. He was hooked. Of all the activities that our kids participate in at the fish shack, stacking firewood, fishing for halibut, checking crab pots, cleaning shrimp, They are most passionate about the task of flipping over rocks along the water's edge as they search for the crabs, snails, pile worms, and sculpins that can be found beneath. The kids seem to prefer human head-sized rocks. Probably.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.